Okay, the webinar has started. Let me remind everybody what's going on. My name is Rob Hack. My company is Insight Inter Asia. I also represent the Hawaii Pacific Export Council, HPEC. That's a nonprofit based here in Honolulu, helping Hawaii and Pacific-based companies export, learn how to export, what have you. These seminars that we're putting on are part of a grant from DBET, so we'd like to thank DBET for the grant that we have to put these seminars on throughout the year. We have covered and will cover topics like today's logistics meeting, we have marketing, we have finance, we have a half-day course where I know some of you have attended called Export University. We'll have a Taiwan-specific event coming up. I know many of you are interested in the Tokyo International Gift Show, or TIGS, and we'll have a specific event for TIGS and going over how to operate a trade show booth and some of the basics of cultural issues in Japan. That'll be coming later in July. So please look on the website and sign up for all of these events. Again, this is being recorded. It's going out on a webinar to the neighbor islands as well. That's all live, so I have to give you a disclaimer that any questions you ask will be going out to the world and will be recorded, and we'll eventually make it into a video that we're doing here that goes on our YouTube channel, the HPEC YouTube channel, okay? So please know that any questions you ask are public questions and will be answered that way. So with that, I would like to introduce Jamie Lum very quickly from DBET. She's responsible for overseeing the grant that we receive. So please come to the lectern.
Aloha, good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. As Rob said, I'm Jamie Lum. I'm with the Department of Business, Economic Development and Tourism, otherwise known as DBED. I'm here this morning with my colleague, Mark Ritchie, and Mark and I work together to implement the High Step, or the Hawaii State Trade Expansion Program, which is funded by a grant from the U.S. Small Business Administration. So we work with partners like HPEC, like John Holman, many of you know, with the U.S. Department of Commerce, with Joe Burns and his people, James and Lori, with the Small Business Development Centers. We also work with Innovate Hawaii, which is under the High Tech Development Corporation. We work with the Department of Agriculture and with the Foreign Trade Zone that has allowed us to use this nice facility for these kinds of training sessions. But all of these partners, we all work together to implement the High Step. We have basically three components of the program. One, which is our export readiness training, which this training session is a part of. As Rob described, we've had several sessions. We have a lot more coming up. So if you go on our website, which is invest.hawaii.gov, under the exporting tab, you'll find all of the information on the High Step program. And it lists all the training sessions. And that's where you would go to register. Most of you know that have registered online. So we have our export training. That's one component. And that kind of helps to get companies set up for exporting. The whole idea behind the STEP program, why the past administration put money into it, was to help really increase U.S. exports. So that's what each of the states is trying to do through this STEP program. So we do offer these training programs to expose companies that may have never thought of exporting, to those who are already exporting but looking to expand. That's what these training sessions are designed to do, and to get you geared up for other components of the program, which are another component are the Hawaii Pavilions that we organize along with Department of Ag. We have certain trade shows that we've designated as trade shows that we think will be beneficial for Hawaii companies, and we go in and we buy a whole bunch of booth space and we create a Hawaii Pavilion so that every company that participates can be under the Hawaii umbrella, which is a great way to brand ourselves and to help you sell your product. So also look on our website for the pavilions that are being organized. We have a couple that are coming up, and we have an online application for that if you're interested. So again, invest.hawaii.gov. The final component, and which I have to say is something that is we've closed already, and which is a component that a lot of people look for, is our company assistance program, which provides money to companies to help you implement your export development plan. So we had three rounds. It is closed already, so for those of you that might be interested, you can look for it next year. I do want to emphasize, even though the financial assistance part of the program is closed, you know, do please continue to sign up for these export sessions and also look at our Hawaii Pavilion. So in invest.hawaii.gov, I'm Jamie, that's Mark. You'll find our contact info on the website, and if you have any questions, I'll be around afterwards. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jamie.
I would add to that very briefly that even if you aren't attending one of the pavilions, or you're applying for a grant from DBET for travel or what have you, please still contact us at HPEC, because we offer mentoring sessions either in a small group or one-on-one to help you with your export planning. And there's lots of qualified professionals who have been exporting for decades on the HPEC board, and they are very willing and eager to review your plans and raise issues with you that probably you haven't thought of before. So I highly recommend you just get in contact with us, and we can help you build up your export plan so that next year, when you are ready to apply for some grants from DBET for travel or a trade show attendance, that you're much better prepared than you are now, and you have a much higher likelihood of getting approved for those grants. So you're all here. You know, today is the logistics section of our curriculum, and helping us a great deal is UPS. Peter Stams over here is also on the HPEC board, so he's been very instrumental in helping me put together the program today to talk to you about logistics. And with him is Carter Kopak, who is more of an expert on international freight forwarding and ocean freight, these types of issues. So I greatly appreciate them coming in here and giving a lot of their time today. UPS is a company that's very strong in shipping from Hawaii. That's why I'm also eager to have them here. They can break down the complete logistics chain from a shipper to an end user anywhere in the world. And that's what I've asked them to do, is to get a little bit into the weeds and be fairly pedantic about the shipping process so that you understand all of the things that are going on behind the scenes, but also to show you that a company such as UPS, with their global reach, can help you very seamlessly get your products from Hawaii to wherever they need to go in the world, whether that's a lot of you I know are interested in Japan, Korea, China, Singapore, Taiwan, Canada, where, of course, the mainland, but that's not an export. So with that, I would like to bring up the first speaker is Carter Kopak. He's, what would you say, freight forwarding expert?
Yeah, freight forwarding. It's the other presentation.
It's not the one that starts Go Global.
No, it's the UPS. Here's a microphone right here. This is actually the microphone, so you don't have to hold that unless it's like.
Oh, correct.
So I guess while he's figuring this out, introduce myself. So Carter Kopak, like he said, senior account manager in Hawaii here. Originally from Chicago, so I'll warn everybody, if I talk fast, talk too fast, just let me know, put your hand up. Basically what I specialize is in air and ocean freight, both domestically and internationally. I work hand in hand with Peter, who's on the small parcel piece. He'll introduce himself during his presentation. But really what we're here today is obviously UPS is a huge company, right? 400,000 employees, give or take, depending on the year. Our job is to make us really small, to make, you know, we help you guys out. Obviously, the more you grow, the more we grow. So what we're here, we can move freight anywhere in the world, but really we want to know the people behind it, how to help you guys out so you guys can grow. So with that, we'll go to the next slide and just look at the kind of agenda that I put in place for today. So really, what is freight forwarding, right? Where's my role? What's Peter's role? How do I get involved? When to use each of us, who to call? We'll talk about air freight, so that's a big piece of my business, what I handle. Ocean freight then. We'll talk about air versus ocean freight. It was a cheesy video I found that kind of explains some of the different variables to consider. We'll talk about customs clearance. That's something that we get a lot of questions about, right? What kind of paperwork do I need? Importing or exporting, kind of the differences when it comes to that. We'll talk about Incoterms. So I'm not sure, again, coming in here cold, I'm not sure what everyone's expertise level is, if you guys have heard of those or not, but we'll talk about those. Those are good to know. Just some general key points for exporters. So I always kind of put myself in my customer's shoes and say, okay, if I was brand new at this, what are some considerations I like to have off the bat to make sure I'm not getting blindsided by anything major? We'll talk about UPS, the advantage of using a company like UPS. There's definitely some good and bad things. Usually mostly good. There's definitely some places we tend to avoid. We'll talk about battery shipments, some things that we just really don't touch. But with that said, especially on the freight forwarding side, I handle accounts that are military accounts. We've moved Humvees, we've moved helicopters. We've also moved t-shirts. So we kind of run the gap of risk there as far as kind of the products we take. And then with that UPS advantage, right, it usually comes down to three things. It comes down to our service, right? Like every customer here, every company, right, it's about service. We'll talk a little bit about our network, our capabilities there, and then also our investment in technology to make your job easier as you go. So again, there's quite the agenda there. This will probably take 20 to 30 minutes. We'll save questions for the end. So I'll present, then Peter will present. Part of that's because of the live feed. We did secure some prizes, so if you guys want to take some good notes, we'll get you a soccer ball, hat, water bottle. Everybody wants that UPS stuff, right? So with that, we'll go to the next slide, and we'll talk about the freight forwarder, what that role is. So again, generally air and ocean freight, right? When we talk about freight forwarding, we're talking about freight, we're talking about big stuff. Now, big stuff, that's a relative term, right? Generally, I start getting involved 150, 200, 300 pounds. Obviously, Peter's a little smaller than that, but there's gray area there. So depending on the product, depending on the lane you're shipping to, it might make more sense to go a small parcel. It might make more sense to go air freight or ocean freight. But generally, large, palletized, big and heavy freight, that's where a freight forwarder comes into place. We'll help you with documentation, with packaging, destination requirements. So certain countries, right, they're a little bit harder to maybe import in than others. So Brazil, for instance, you have to have documents signed in blue pen. So, there's a lot of like weird things. It's not necessarily to scare you away, but just considerations to think about, right? There is another element to shipping when you do international as opposed to the mainland, especially Hawaii, right? So Hawaii I obviously cover Hawaii as well as to the mainland to and from. There's also some unique things to consider, so we help you with that. So we have a worldwide network of offices and agents with capabilities to track and trace shipments. One of the advantages of UPS is we're dealing with UPSers all the time. So we have good relationships with our Japan counterparts, with our Chinese counterparts, Australian, really throughout the world. The freight forwarding piece, we have flexibility really to do anything and everything. So if you want us to help just with documents, if you want us to just get it, I need it from, Waianae to the port of Honolulu, we can handle just that piece. Or it could be as extensive as door-to-door. I need it from my business in Honolulu all the way to Sydney, Australia. And we can kind of piecemeal each part of that out. So we're here to help you guys out in any kind of capacity you need. Again, we kind of talked about air and ocean, right? There's obviously different service levels. I didn't delve too much into our names of the service levels just because I figured you guys would remember that, and that's not why you guys came here. But with that said, there's next flight out, there's consolidations, there's LCL on the ocean piece, we'll talk more about that, full container loads, and kind of everything and anything in between. So really the bottom line is, right, we're here to assist you in your supply chain and make sure you guys are making educated decisions, again, to avoid that blind side and make sure the growth pattern and the risk that you may be taking, you're aware of, and just to help you guys grow. So we'll go on the next slide then. So UPS Air Freight, just a little bit of a snapshot of what we do with the UPS Air Freight. 486 facilities across 172 countries. So our global footprint with UPS is pretty large. You know, we didn't get our own airlines until 1988. With that said, now we have about 236 UPS airplanes. Now, one of the differences between UPS forwarding and UPS small parcel is small parcel is asset-based. So when you go with UPS small parcel, every single thing that touches that shipment will be UPS driver, UPS airplane, UPS operations. On the forwarding side, we're non-asset-based. So that's one of the advantages for UPS forwarding, right? We can use our own airplanes, so we definitely do, right? We use planes to Hong Kong, to the mainland, but we also can use other airliners. So we have contracts in place with Korean Airlines, United, Hawaiian Airlines, right? So that's, again, it's a little bit difference there. Sometimes that can be a little frustrating. At times that can also be really rewarding, right? Because if you need, I need a shipment, we just moved a shipment from China to Hawaii, we use Korean, it opens up possibilities there. So again, the knowledge of that's important just because it kind of separates what we do more or less. So with air freight, right, again, international door-to-door, our airport to airport services, they're non-guaranteed internationally. So Peter's, most of his products can be guaranteed. It's another difference, right? Mine are non-guaranteed. It says 3 to 5. Now, again, depending on when you ship it, depending on the country you're trying to get to, it may take longer. Hawaii especially, right? We're in the middle of the ocean. But generally, it's 3 to 5 days anywhere in the world. And then again, both palletized and loose freight. So it doesn't always have to be that perfect cube when you think about the palletized freight. I'll show you one a picture of those. It could also be loose freight. So really, any and everything again. If you want to go to the next picture, here's just a picture of we call a unit load device, a ULD. I don't know how many people have seen these. I'm sure if you've flown at the airport, you see these getting loaded in. So these are what we use. We actually have our own facility in Honolulu here. It's about 17,000 square feet. Hawaii is a little different. So I'm from Chicago. I worked in Milwaukee. I've been here now about 2 years. Hawaii, some customers actually have these in their business, which is unique. I've never seen that before except Hawaii. So it's a very educated base here we're working with. But that's generally what goes in the airplane. You can see that picture dated 1995. Not much has changed as far as the technology there. It's still the same old ULDs. If you want to go to the next picture then, we'll show the inside of a cargo plane. So obviously it's a cargo plane, right? There's no seating. Again, when you use Peter's services, it's going to be in a UPS Browntail, that's what we call airlines, or 5X, that's our call signal. That's what it will look like. Now, for me, we may use passenger airlines, so maybe just the bottom, but this is what it looks like inside. You know, again, not too much to explain there, pretty simple cut and dry, but that's just a visual to kind of understand, hey, how does it look when it goes in there? And we'll pack that all the way tight. And I'll talk more about packaging and the importance of packaging, but again, you want to make sure things are packaged securely and safely. We obviously have a claims department. We have insurance, but like anything, if you're proactive in that, hopefully the best insurance is the insurance you never have to use, right? The claim you never have to claim. So that's something to think about. So we'll go to the next slide then. Talk about UPS ocean freight. So again, service on 1,900 direct lanes. We are a NVOCC and a freight forwarder, so a non-vessel operating common carrier. What is that? That basically means we do not own the ships. So we don't, you know, we use Matson, we use Maersk, Costco. We don't own those ships. And we're a freight forwarder. So the easiest way to think about what a freight forwarder is per se, when it comes to ocean freight or air freight, is we're just a travel agent. We handle the documents, we handle the booking. We can certainly help you with filling those documents out, but we cannot assume risk and say, you know, if you were to classify this as a chair, okay, it's not a chair. So that's on you to understand that. We'll talk about reasonable care down the line, but we can help. We cannot do everything for you. Again, any size shipment, so full container loads, those generally come in 20s and 40s. So I'm sure you've seen those out there, right? That's generally what they are. They also come in 40 high cubes, 45. They do open top. Again, we can really do basically anything that you're looking for within reason. So our LCL service, right, so 97% of the world's GDP, we are trading partners with that. So anywhere where really growth's happening or there's money to be made, we're there for you. Again, because we're an NVOCC, we have access to all those steamship lines. So Maersk, Matson, those are some of the major ones, NYK, we can do all that. And just last year, we processed over a little over 500,000 20-foot equivalent units, so 20-foot containers. So again, as I said in the introduction, right, we can move freight. Whether I'm here or Peter's here, UPS is going to move freight. It's our job to kind of understand the customer and what you guys need.
Can you explain what FCL, LCL is?
Yeah, so FCL, the question was, The question was, what is FCL and LCL? So they're just acronyms, right? Full container load and less than container load. So when we talk about FCLs, we're talking about 20 foot, 40 foot, the entire container, right? It goes to your dock, you lock it, it doesn't get opened up until the final delivery point. LCL, right, you're gonna share that container. So quick advantages of LCL versus FCL. It's gonna be cheaper. FCL is gonna be a little bit more secure, right? Because it's gonna be locked. When you're LCL, you know, right, everyone in the business, right, there's stuff in that container. So it's gonna be braced up against something else. That's where packaging becomes really important. General rule of thumb, again, this is a gray area here, but if you can utilize 60% of a full container load, you should probably get the full container. Now that's dependent upon, again, every situation is a little different, but a general rule of thumb is you can fill a little bit over half, it makes more sense to go full container. And really it makes sense, right? It's kind of cool. You know, small parcels a little different, but I mean, you could get a 40-foot container, you know, which is really, I don't know, for me to you, you know, a pretty big space for a couple thousand dollars to China, which is kind of interesting. I mean, that's a pretty good deal. You really, small parcels would be a lot more. So, kind of depending on what you need, it kind of goes again what you need.
20-foot or 40-foot?
Both. So a full container, just for, you know, it's again, it's just you're taking the entire container, and from there it could be a 20, 40, 45 high cube from going out. If you want to go to the next slide, we'll talk about just some of the differences. What I mentioned, we're a freight forwarder and NVOCC. Some companies are one or the other. We are both. UPS, again, we kind of do it all. Again, the easiest way to think about it is the freight forwarder is a travel agent, prepares the cargo for carriage, arranges inland transportation, books the cargo, and prepares documentation for exports. So kind of holds your hand on the documentation piece. And the NVOCC, basically, we're just buying space from the big steamships. Again, we'll get into pricing later on, but at the bottom there, right, leverage volume to negotiate service contracts with discounted rates. So yes, there is something to be said about volume. If you can commit to a certain amount of volume, right, we can go in there and negotiate things better. We can get signed contracts. And when I say volume, right, on our end, what we're talking about, NSAs, those are non-service agreements, we're talking 200-300 containers. So I don't know how many people do that right now, but the volume has to be pretty significant. And when you're talking about more than that, then you probably want to go direct to steamship lines. So you'll bypass UPS and you'll go right to Maersk and say, okay, I have 500 steamships or 500 containers I need, and they'll offer you pricing. So we're in that next layer of group of like 200 containers to all the way to, I move an LCL shipment, 3 pallets a month. That's where we would come into place. And again, that's a decision we could talk about offline if you have questions about. But that's the major differences between the freight forwarder and VOCC. And a steamship line is a VOCC, right? They're a vessel operating common carrier. So just, I know there's a lot of acronyms, UPS, we're an acronym company. So again, good question on the LCL, FCL, and we'll move on to the next one. So this is just a visual representation of how the freight flows, right, from an ocean freight perspective. It's similar on the air freight perspective. So you can see local pickup, and you can see the red is the freight forwarding piece. And yellow is the NVOCC. So really, NVOCC is like a VOCC, right? They're really handling just that ocean piece. That's what we're handling, and the freight forwarder handles all the documentation. Now, I starred cargo insurance, right, because I mentioned it earlier. So ocean insurance is a little bit different. It has its own, because maritime law, and there's a lot of unique things about it. If you want to go to that next slide, it kind of does a better job of explaining what I'm talking about. So on the ocean, that's not UPS, right? That's somebody else. General average, right? So general average basically states if you're one of those containers that's obviously going to fall off, right, that's your container. I paid $2,000 for that. You're obviously going to be at a loss for that, right? That's going to be your loss. Now, a freight ship is very deep. I don't know if anyone's ever seen one up top, right? It probably goes, depending on the size, 4, 8, 10 containers deep. Those containers are going to be safe. So in the act of a storm or some kind of cataclysmic event, right, the captain's got to make a quick decision. Oh, I got to get rid of those to save the rest of the ship, to save my crew. Everyone on board is responsible for the loss of those containers. So whether you're in the bottom and you're, oh, it's not me, not my problem, right, it is your problem. Everyone shares that responsibility. So when we talk about insurance, right, that's really, you really got to kind of understand, okay, what business insurance do I have? I mean, having a conversation with your insurance provider. Okay, well, what is the claim process? What's covered? What's not covered? Because again, it's had me for, I've been a freight forwarder for 5 years. I've had one person get it. It's never a fun conversation. But again, it does happen. So just something to think about when you're talking about exporting or importing, ocean especially, there's a lot of like unique rules to think about that, again, you'd rather have those conversations up front than what's this bill in the mail for, you know, $800 or whatever it is, or more than that. So again, that's just something to think about. I always kind of add it in there because it's a unique thing that most people do not know about. If you want to go to the next slide, this just kind of gives you an idea of the size of these ships. So Hawaii, right, a lot of people ask me about the Jones Act, right? So that means basically the Jones Act is to get from a mainland or to get from a U.S. port, it has to be a U.S. flagged ship, cargo ship, right? So Matson, that's one of them. That's why you don't see a lot of NYK. Now you can actually, okay, the Jones Act, you can actually take from Asia to Hawaii. Well, you don't see a lot of those, right? And it's not economical, right? You have a ship like this that handles roughly 15,000 20-foot containers. The biggest ship in the Hawaii port's about 3,500. So these ships are getting bigger and bigger, and from a, you know, a company like Maersk, why we go to Hawaii? We could just go to the mainland and let them figure it out, right? So, you know, I mean, does the Jones Act certainly have negatives? Yes. But I think, again, it just goes back to we're Hawaii, right? We're in the middle of an ocean. It's going to cost money whether you're shipping anywhere in the world or the most remote place on Earth. And we could talk more about the Jones Act offline, but I know that's something that maybe people have heard about. But for the most part, it's got to be, again, a U.S. flagged ship from a port to a port. And depending on the lanes and your business, it may help or hurt you. So again, it's been passed since 1920. There's been a lot of legislation in Congress to maybe get rid of it, but like a lot of legislation, it hasn't gotten passed. So if you want to go to the next slide then, just to show you the size up close, right? There's like a regular little, you know, five-person ship next to the big Emma Maersk. So this one is 15,000. The largest one to LA is 17,000 TEU. So they're just getting bigger and bigger, right? They're trying to fit more and more. And certain times that's good. Certain times that's not good. If they can't fill that ship up, it's good for the shippers or buyers because you get better rates. But that's just an idea of the ocean freight. The next slide will take us into the video.
Okay, bear with me.
So you'll get a break from my voice. So a lot of the questions, just to lead this in, right, when do I know if it's air freight or ocean freight? And the simplest way to think about it is, right, it's like an, it's cost, right? It's going to cost you more to get air freight. But if you need something, then you got to go air freight. But this will talk about kind of, I think it's eight different considerations, just to kind of get your head around some of the considerations to think about. So if you want to go ahead and play that. And again, I apologize for the cheesiness, but it does a good job explaining things.
Universal Shipping News presents a showdown for the ages. It's like Ali versus Frazier, Pacquiao versus Mayweather, Tyson versus Holyfield. The two heavyweights of international shipping are facing off. That's right, it's air freight versus ocean freight. We're using boxing as a metaphor to show how air freight and ocean freight match up in eight different categories because, well, obviously I know a lot about boxing. Round one. Speed. Speed is important when it comes to a fighter so he can dodge jabs and get some of his own in there. But it's also important when it comes to international shipping. Air freight is a much faster way to ship. While air freight tends to deliver cargo in just days, ocean freight tends to take weeks, sometimes even a month or two. If you need your cargo delivered fast, you want air freight. Round two. Reliability. When it comes to a fight, you want someone you can count on in your corner. It's the same when it comes to international shipping. When it comes to reliability, ocean carriers are notoriously bad. On top of that, if you miss a voyage or a voyage is canceled, you're talking about a week, maybe a two-week delay for your cargo. On the other hand, airlines tend to be on top of their schedules, and they have daily flights between most major cities around the world. So if a flight is canceled or delayed because of weather or you miss it for some reason, you're only talking about maybe a day's delay for your cargo. The reliability round goes to air freight. Round three, cost. Ask any fighter and they'll tell you that being the best does not come without a cost. So it's no surprise then that the leader in both speed and reliability is going to cost you more. Air freight tends to be much more expensive than ocean shipping. In fact, it can often be five or six times as much. Now there are a few rare occasions when air freight can actually come down and be cheaper than ocean freight, but the clear winner in terms of cost is ocean freight. Round four, capacity. This is like the advantage a big fighter has over a small fighter. When it comes to capacity, there is no contest. ocean freight wins. In fact, ocean freight struggles with overcapacity, while space for air cargo is extremely limited. The larger the quantity or size of the cargo that you want to move, the more likely it is that you want to go with ocean freight. Round 5, destinations. This is a close round because you can pretty much ship anywhere in the world using both ocean freight or air freight. However, a fighter does tend to be at an advantage when he's on his home turf. And the farther you are inland, the farther you are away from ocean shipping's home turf. That means that you'll have to spend more money on trucking, rail, or short sea shipping in order to reach the final destination. Destinations? Advantage, air freight. Round 6, tracking. You always need to see everything that's going on in a fight. Well, you want the same thing when it comes to your international shipping. But whether you're doing air freight or ocean freight, you're going to be able to have tracking the whole way on your shipment. This round is a tie. Round 7, logistical complications. A good fighter always has a strategy when facing an opponent. And when going into international shipping, you also want a strategy. But you also want things to be as simple as possible, I would imagine. So what's easier, air freight or ocean freight? Well, really, you're going to be dealing with the same kind of complications either way. The paperwork, the custom clearance, the laws, the fees that are different from country to country. Either way, you're going to want a logistics provider like a freight forwarder on your side who knows the ins and outs of international shipping. So really, this ends up being a tie. Round 8, environmental impact. Footwork is important in a boxing match, and in the real world, our ecological footprint is very important. CO2 emissions are much lower when you're shipping by ocean than when you're shipping by plane. So when it comes to being green, ocean freight becomes the winner. Who wins the international shipping belt? It's a tough call. 3 rounds went to air freight, 3 rounds went to ocean freight, 2 rounds were ties. What it really comes down to is which factors are most important for your current cargo. Do you need speed or do you need lower costs? One's going to take you to air, one's going to take you to sea. You can find out more about all of this at universalcargo.com. Until next time, stay in ship shape.
Again, cheesy video, but I got the message across, right? He had a lot of good points. The one thing I will say about tracking, right? He said tracking's good on both. Ocean tracking is a lot more difficult, right? Because you can imagine you're one, you're that one container in a 15,000 container vessel. We'll do our best to let you know where it's at, but there's just a lot more that can go wrong because that voyage is a lot longer. So just something to think about. But again, it's dependent on your product, how fast you need it, right? If your profit margins are through the roof, then yeah, air freight, right? Get it in here. I don't care. But if your margins are a lot thinner, then you probably want to import more via ocean, so or export more via out ocean. So something to consider. We'll go to the next slide, talk about customs clearance. Anytime I talk about customs clearance, right, the first thing I always want to talk about is know your product, know the customer, know the country, right? Everything depends on those really three things. We talk about classifications of product, right? You need to demonstrate reasonable care. So again, if you're gonna, if you're bringing in this, right, you're gonna say it's like a table, or you know, that's a table. Well, why is it a table? Well, it's got 4 legs. I can put things on it, right? You need to be able to demonstrate why it is. Just audit protection, right, in case the government comes and says, you know, we noticed you're importing tables, but if you want a cheaper duty code, so you're saying chairs, but it's not a chair. So again, be honest up front. Audits do happen, fines do happen, and they tend to cause delays as well if you're not getting audited as well. Again, for UPS, right, largest customs broker, we have more than 400 import and export locations, and last year we did more than 6 million entries. That said, UPS, right, we're a large company, we're a very conservative company, so if we see something, right, I know I've had customers where they'll import something under a different code, right, because maybe a bicycle part is cheaper than a tire. Well, if we notice it's a bicycle tire, that's what we're going to do. We'll stop business. We'll say, hey, you can go somewhere else. And other companies will definitely take it. I've lost customers because of that. It's frustrating. But we are very conservative. We're going to do what's right most of the time. We're going to cross our T's, dot our I's. We could talk more about how to classify things offline if you have specific questions. There was a Modernization Act passed in Congress in 1993 that puts the onus on the importer to classify things correctly. Now, we have services you can pay for that will help you and will do it for you. Again, that's going to depend upon how much you're willing to spend. Does it make sense? The reasonable care concept, they kind of make it scarier than it is, right? you know, if this is a pen, why is it a pen? It's got ink in there, I write with it. Okay, you're golden, right? You don't have to overthink it. It's really for the people that are trying to, you know, get away with things, right? Well, it's clearly a computer, but I'm gonna classify it as a tablet because that's a better duty code. That's where we run into issues. So if we catch that, we will stop business doing with you. Penalties are worse from the government than UPS, trust me, they're just stopping business. So just something to think about. Export.gov, I have a whole list of websites at the end of this presentation, but that's a really good place to start if you want to talk about scheduling or classifying your products. The next page just kind of shows our global reach, right? You can see we're basically anywhere where there's anyone, we're basically there. Again, that's a huge advantage too, right? Because if you have questions about, I'm trying to get to China, I don't know if the paperwork's filled out. I've had customers, right? We've moved shrimp to Hong Kong or China, right? And we actually send the documents in advance. So if there's an issue, right, we try to catch it. Now, that's not all the time, but if it's your first time, we'll try to help you out, right? Because once you get the first time, it's like anything. Then it's repetition. You can save the format and all that stuff. But that's a huge advantage. So if you have questions, right, I may not know them, but I can definitely get the right person involved, which is a nice advantage. The next slide kind of talks about transportation and customs clearance, right? The easiest way to think about it, you need one and the other, right? It's milk and cookies, it's eggs and bacon, it's peanut butter and jelly. So when you talk about importing, you talk about the harmonized tariff schedule, HTS codes. So I'm sure most people have imported here. When you talk about exporting, it's Schedule B numbers. Similar, not the same. So they're both 10 digits. Again, Schedule B is only US exports. So, you know, let's say you're sending umbrellas, that's why I found an example, right? Umbrellas to Germany. We have a certain 10-digit code. Now that 10-digit code in Germany is different. So that would delay the shipment, right? That's why you have to work with your shipper and consignee to figure out, okay, what's the right code? And again, you don't see it. It's not too much of a problem with exporting, right? Because it's kind of their problem, right? And that's what I would say. When you're exporting, it's the importer's job to know what's going on, right? Lean on them. Hey, I don't know what it is. You guys should kind of know this and work together. Now, on the opposite end, when you're doing import, and I know it's an export thing again, but you know, generally you're importing as well, it's on you to know what it is, right? So I know customers on importing, well, you know, I got this from Australia, and they classified it like this. It's like, well, that's not reasonable care. You can't just say, oh, it's not my problem. It is your problem, right? It's your customer. It's your company. So take the time, understand what it is, communicate that effectively. Again, because improper paperwork, improper codes, not doing the work up front, you know, delays. And then again, fines can, and I'll show you an example of a customer that got a big fine. But it does happen, right? It's kind of like taxes. It's like, you know, don't lie on your taxes. Yeah, do they really care about what car Copac makes? No. But I do it right because, God forbid, anything does happen, I get audited, I'm good. So again, you just want to take the time, do it right. And again, that's something to consider, right? Maybe we have quotas. Maybe there's a census, right? There's a reason they do it. Just to make sure everything's on the up and up. So again, you have... Provides what?
Support.
Yeah, we can help you out. The question was, does UPS provide support? We'll talk about some technology, tradability. That's one of the websites. But really the best way to go is just export.gov. So that was one of the websites on there. Again, I've sat with customers on the importing side. We could do with exporting, right? If you import 1,000 codes, I'm not going to sit with you and, you know, do every single code. But if you have five, yeah, let's grab a pizza. We can do it together. Okay, this is this. It's a pretty simple classification breakdown. So we're here to help. If you want to go to the next slide then. So I mentioned Incoterms, right? Incoterms are really terms that kind of facilitate international trade. So that next slide will go international commercial terms of sale. So what are they, right? They're used really between sellers and buyers as a standard set of terms. You can imagine if there weren't any of these, right, the amount of the language barrier, the government barrier to kind of make sure, hey, how do I get a quote? What am I paying for? There's 11 of them, so 11 current Incoterms. I'll kind of go over the major three for exporters. Really, there's three or four that, again, I deal with, I'd say, 95% of the time. So you really have to really only think about four. They are effective 2011. They do change. They'll probably change again in 2020, just every 10 years. I think they kind of get a redo. So we can go to the next slide. We'll show you the major three, right, I highlighted. So Ex-Works. So if your company say, okay, I do Ex-Works, right? How do you pay for this stuff? It's Ex-Works. Ex-Works means the seller just has to get the goods on their port, on their dock. So all I have to do is prepare it, and then the The buyer handles inland transportation at the origin. They handle the transportation either through the air or ocean. They handle all the documents. They handle basically everything, right? All you gotta do is get the freight ready and let the buyer deal with it. Now, good and bad, right? So if you're doing one or two of those a year, I don't wanna deal with it, right? I don't care, it's not my problem. I got my money, I don't care, that's great. That's what you would go. Now, I've had some customers, right, they do Ex Works initially, and then they grow and grow and grow, and then you're trying to manage, okay, well, this freight company's coming at 8 a.m., this company's coming at 9 a.m., like, it becomes more of a headache, as well as you're kind of missing a profit center, right? So if you can control that shipping, that's another way to make money. So the same way certain people don't want to deal with shipping on the selling end, they don't want to deal with on the buying end. If you can say, hey, you can get it to my door and just build in that cost, that's great. So again, Ex Works is the easiest, I would say, for the seller, because all you got to do is prepare that freight, get it on your dock, wash your hands, see you later. The other end would be DAP and DDP, so delivered at place, delivered duty paid. That's generally when the seller takes care of everything to their name place. So we say name place, you're getting it to their door, say, but you're not handling any of the duties, taxes, customs, brokerage paperwork. The other end of that is DDP, where really you're paying for everything, right? We're going to take care of it from our facility to your facility. We're going to handle the taxes, the duties, all that nonsense. Now, I would generally recommend DAP if you're going to take care of the shipping, right? Because it's their country, right? If you're exporting to a different country, if you don't have a representation there, you don't understand the rules, the regulations, that's what I would recommend. Because certain countries, right, we have our duties and taxes here. Our duties, rather, right? So if you're importing pens at 10% rate, $100 shipping, the duty rate's 10%, it's a $10 charge. In certain countries like China, right, there's value-added tax. I'm sure maybe VAT, if anyone's ever heard of that, right? So there's value-added tax on top of that. So there's ways to reclaim that, but again, when it comes to duties, and if it's your country, I would recommend taking care of it. If it's not your country, push back on the buyer, say, I'm not gonna handle that, that's on you. That would be my advice. Now, I know customers that do it successfully, they've had headaches, and again, depending on the size, how much time you wanna spend. But again, DAP is what I recommend if you wanna take care of the shipping. If you want to go the easiest route, I would say Ex Works. And then the fourth one that I deal a lot with is FOB. So FOB means really you're going to get it to the major port of exportation. So here would be the Honolulu port. We're going to get our stuff to the Honolulu port, and then it's on you. Or you get it to LA. So again, there's obviously ranges through that, right? And we'll talk about the other ones here. If you want to go to the next slide. Again, I wish I had these to hand these out, but we don't have them at our office. But really you can see, right, the 11 Incoterms on the left there. On the top is Ex Works, right? And you can see the buyer's responsibility, the seller's responsibility, and kind of where it all goes and who's in charge or what, right? So you can see Ex Works. Product cost and export booking, that's it. You're done. It's on the buyer to figure everything else out. At the opposite end, right, is DDP. You're basically the seller's responsible for everything. And through that is a lot of formalities. But again, those three, if you want to add the fourth one, the FOB, are the ones we deal with the most. And again, you can Google search these if you want. If you have more questions, we can talk offline. But a quick Google search, well, this is a UPS branded one. There's probably better ones out there, I'll be honest. Okay, so a little more simpler. But that's just to give you a kind of visual representation of, okay, what are all the things I got to think about when that ownership or responsibility passes over, right? Because like I said, if you're shipping via ocean and you get it to the port and everything goes great, and then it's an FOB term, and then that container ship falls over, it's not your responsibility anymore. But now where does that take place? That's where Incoterms come into place. The next slide will kind of go over what Incoterms are not, though. So they're not fail-safe, right? They're not law. So if you have an issue with a buyer, so you can't say, well, it was Ex Works, that was it. No, that's not, you know, the judge would be like, okay, well, that's great, but that's not law. They're not all-inclusive, right? So that's where you want to have that good relationship. Like I say, know your customers, right? Understand where the sales, the contract, where all that stuff happens. They do not address the passage of title. Really, it's just to facilitate growth, right? To facilitate the conversation, to get quotes, to get pricing, to say, okay, here's how we've done it in the past. But then you want to be careful, right, to make sure you have other things in place to protect yourself. So just kind of like, well, they're law. No, they're not law. Again, they're just there to help facilitate international trade. Just an important point. The next slide, we'll talk about the UPS difference, right? So one of the major differences, I guess, between Peter and I, too, is Peter has one major competitor, right? They're purple. Okay, you guys probably know who they are. We're not allowed to say them. I have a ton of competitors, right? DHL, Panalpina, Expeditors, the list goes on and on and on. Mom and pop type stuff, right? So we'll talk about the value of UPS from a forwarding perspective here, and I think it carries over to small parcel as well. So we talk about service, right? So I'm the local account manager for all the Hawaiian Islands. So I'm the only freight forwarding rep for Hawaii for UPS. Peter, I think has about two or three other people that he kind of works with directly with small parcel. I'm the only one. So I handle Kauai. I've been to Molokai, right? We have customers moving shrimp from there, the Big Island, all that fun stuff. With that said, we have specified teams to help with your business. So if you're a really large shipper, right, you have questions about documents, you have questions about how to classify things, right? There's ways we can help you out. So we're this big machine, right? And part of Peter and I job, Peter's job and my job is to make sure that UPS is working for you. A lot of the competitors I deal with, and I think Peter probably similarly, right, they're based in LA or Tacoma or Seattle, which is great, but time difference happens, things change, you want that local representation that can pronounce things right as well. That's another barrier we have to, you know, the mainland, I call the mainland, they don't understand how to say things. Again, local operational context. So again, I mentioned that right by the airport, we have a 17,000 square foot warehouse. So we do warehousing as well. We do distribution, pick and pack. Again, we're gonna do that if that makes business sense for us, right? Just like you guys wanna make money, UPS, believe it or not, wants to make money. So we can have those conversations and see if we align on those things as well. We obviously have certain niches or niches. I'm not sure how you say that. So one of those is we're the only nonstop direct flight to Hong Kong from Hawaii. So if that's a market you want to get into, you want to fly some things over, literally we cannot be beat price-wise or time-wise. So I'll put that out there right now. That's where we're trying to grow. Hong Kong is definitely a niche, as well as for Peter too. So it's a UPS plane. So right, Peter has some space, I have some space. It's great. And UPS Capital. So we talked about insurance earlier. UPS Capital, that's kind of our finance and insurance piece. That's kind of a game changer. Obviously insurance, pretty cut and dry there. The finance piece, I'll just touch on briefly. So again, I know this is an export, right? But importing containers, I'm sure people have done that, right? So one of the cool things about the finance piece of that, if you're importing from China, right, and you have $100,000 worth of goods in that container, it's a lot of money. Standard terms are 30 days, say. It takes around 25, 30, 35 days to get. So you're paying for that 100K before you can ever get it to your own warehouse and move it, right? I mean, that's a lot of money out there before you get it. So with our UPS Capital product, we can actually finance that container. So if you're gonna say, okay, it's 100,000, we can give you 70,000 as soon as that airway or master bill is created. So then you can pay the lights, you can take your employees to dinner, whatever you wanna do. It makes things a little bit easier. So again, that's something we can talk offline, but I just wanna touch that, throw that out there. We talked about our network, right? UPS offices worldwide. So when I email someone, it's UPS or email. And again, that helps a lot, right? We do have agents, very few, limited, certain areas of the world, but they have the same standards as we do. We hold them accountable. But it is nice, right? We're talking with UPS. We get on a conference call. If we have questions about, hey, have we had a shipment, you know, again, when we move shrimp, we moved some shrimp to Abu Dhabi, actually. That was crazy, but a good learning experience. So we were able to get on the phone. Okay, how's it work? What's the, you know, when it gets there, what's going to happen? So we lean on them. The other good thing about having a large network, you know, it's on there, right? Information flow is equal to freight flow. Now everyone here wants to know about freight flow, right? Well, how's this moving? What's the time in transit? On the forwarding side, there's a lot more mistakes or things that go wrong, right? Peter, and he'll talk about his domestic, I don't know about the international, but the on-time rate's around 97%, 98% all the time. Okay, we are not that. Be totally honest, no one is in the freight world. Mainland air freight, I would say, is on time, depending on the service level, anywhere from and time of the year, 80%, sometimes 90, but we have a lot more issues, right? There's a lot more steps in our process. So with the network, right, if we can let you know, hey, there's a backlog in China, there's a storm in Germany, we can let you know that can help you guys plan better as well. So that's the advantage there. And then technology, right? We talked about if their websites or how can we classify things. So QuantumView and FlexGlobalView, those are kind of our big track and trace, I would say, technology. We've invested billions of dollars in those. And again, there's a lot of capability in all this technology, but part of our role is to make sure that you're using it correctly, that it's helping you. So what might help customer A may mean nothing to customer B, may mean something to customer C, and maybe, you know, the truth to customer D. Now with some of this technology, it's kind of neat. We have visibility for documents. So if you're a first-time shipper, you want to know what the documents look like. If you ship a lot, and you have a question of, okay, I know I'm shipping something to China, but I forget what PO it is, or I forget who signed delivery of this, or whatever it is, we have actually the exact images. We scan them in there, and then if you're the major principal party, within 24 hours, they'll all be there for you. So again, I don't think any of my customers use it all the time, but here and there, they may use it, and we can run reports. There's a lot we can do. So again, when it comes to the UPS, you know, where do we kind of hang our hat? First and foremost, service, then the network, we rely on that a lot, and then technology. This next piece, we'll talk about moving freight with UPS, just kind of how it works with the UPS model. I'm gonna click through that. The general overview of how it works, right? So really, you don't need an account to ship with UPS right now. So if you're, oh man, I'm gonna do it right today, you can literally leave here and say, UPS, I wanna move this to China. Now there's gonna be paperwork needed, right? We're gonna need a check right away because we don't have credit established, but we can do that right away. So we make it really easy to move things. The way that we approach things is, right, you contact us, we're gonna create an account. So there's multiple accounts, because UPS is such a huge company, right, that's like an umbrella. So there's supply chain solutions, which is kind of what I deal with. There's small parcel, there's ground, there's brokerage, right, we're a huge company. So they're all gonna be different accounts. We can get established with credit, okay, and you're gonna have terms. That way we can just move things, you don't have to have a check right away for us. We can generally link credit across accounts. If not, there's a standard 5-page application. It takes about 10 minutes, depending on how fast you can write. And then from there, we'll talk about pricing, right, and rate agreements. So Peter can talk about this when he's up here about how that works for him. For me, right, because we're non-asset-based, so if it's air freight and you're going to say, I'm going to move Honolulu to Hong Kong, we'll put a pricing structure in place. Now, I do not sign contracts, so Peter, he'll get a contract out, he'll say, okay, here's your tier, I believe, you know, correct me if I'm wrong here, but he'll do that, and you'll have to honor commitments. Now, same here, if you say I'm going to ship every week to Australia, and then 6 months goes and you only ship once, I'm going to go, hey, man, what's going on here? And we can work through that. And that said, it's on the onus of the business owner to understand the shipping costs as well, right? So if you're moving with us and you're saying, man, I'm paying, I don't know, something absorbing, you know, $20 a kilo to Australia, that seems high, yeah, quote it up. I would recommend that. I mean, especially if you're brand new to this, what's it going to hurt? Oh, it's high. Oh, I'm getting a really good deal. I mean, I would definitely put it out there to different people. Now, we're going to be as competitive as we can, right? I mean, that makes sense. But I'm very open to saying, yeah, go quote somebody else. Especially the larger the shipment, right, the more quotes I would kind of gather. So let's say UPS is your favorite carrier, right? But I'm going to move 10,000 pounds, which is a lot. That shipment's probably going to be worth 20, 30K, depending on where it's going. I would quote that out. See what some competitor can do. Again, worst case scenario, you just say, well, yeah, I'm getting a great deal. Awesome. Cool. So with this pricing agreement, though, it does depend on quite a few things, right? So space available, peak seasons, fuel, so many variables, which is part of why we do not sign contracts. That said, the more volume you have, the more competitive rates we can generally give you. And again, the volume thresholds are quite large, but we're here to work with you. Obviously, we want to win the business too, right? The more you grow, the more we grow. So if we're way out of whack, we're not going to get any business. So again, the more information you can provide us, the better we can come back with a solution. Spot rates, I'll touch on quickly. So spot rates are really, throughout the year, there are times where spot rates may be really cheap. So they may be better than if you have a pricing agreement in place, right? So I spent some time in Milwaukee. A few times there was Shanghai, where our plane from Shanghai to ORD, Chicago, O'Hare, was empty. So literally, the air freight cost was zero. Now there's fuel and there's other, so it's not a free shipment. But, you know, if it's an empty bird, empty plane, that's not doing us any good. So there are times through the year where, okay, well, there's this big push to get Shanghai to Chicago or Shanghai to LA. Now it's infrequent, and there's no real pattern to it per se, but that's something you might want to take advantage of. And then again, the last piece I already talked about a little bit, but just review the performance in the market. So as much as Peter and I try to, again, educate the customers, and we're going to try to put our best foot forward and say, here's the best price we can do, and yeah, your rates are average, or your rates are, you know, market average, it is on you to make sure your shipping costs are in line at all times. So when I inherited Milwaukee, for instance, that territory was vacant for a year, so a lot of my customers were getting, you know, there were rate hikes. So you can imagine, okay, 5% rate hike, no one did anything about it, and another 5%. Well, now you're talking 10%. It built and built. So you want to make sure you're looking at those costs, right? Self-report yourself. Okay, well, this is getting higher and higher. Who do I call? Because as much of it is, you know, again, it's Peter's and I job. It's your company. It's your business. So yeah, me and Peter, oh, it looks bad on us, right? It's a bad day. We can go home. That's your business. That's your company. Make sure you take responsibility of the shipping costs, just like anything else with your business, right? Make sure you know what you're doing. The next slide, general key points for exporters. So you want to hit the next one. Just kind of how the measurements work, right? So upper deck, lower deck, maximums. Upper deck is going to be generally more expensive than lower deck for air freight. You know, pretty cut and dry there, 96 inches on the upper deck, 64 on the lower deck. If it is bigger, right, we've chartered airplanes for military accounts. We're going to move 35 Humvees to Japan. We've done it. It's going to cost you a couple hundred grand, but we can do that for you. The next one, again, know your customer and your product. Can't say that enough. When you're exporting to a new country, become familiar with the country regulations. Is an import license required? Do I need to go through inspections? Certificate of origin? What do I need to make sure I'm covered? The next slide goes over again, Incoterms. Know them and use them. Commercial invoice. Again, I'm coming in here cold, so I don't know how much people know about commercial invoices, but again, never underestimate the power of a Google search. I'll add that in as well. You can learn a lot. Packing, right? Good packing provides protection, just less headaches. Again, we have a claim department. Like any insurance claim department, it's not the easiest to work with. I work for UPS, and I'll say that. I deal with them quite a bit. You know, the less you got to deal with claims in general, the better. And lastly, insurance, right? I know we talk about ocean insurance, but air freight as well, right? When does responsibility pass on to the seller? If I have an ocean container, I'm exporting, and I'm, you know, let's say I'm moving a DAP, right? So I'm taking all that responsibility, and it gets dropped in the ocean. What happens to me, right? I would have that conversation just to make sure you're not taking a huge loss when, you know, you're not expecting it. So this last one's just an example of a customer. I don't know how many people are moving iron and selenium to India, but this happens. They didn't have the required export licenses. Okay, a $300,000 penalty. And the government, when they want their money, they get their money. So again, best case is UPS says, hey, we can't move that for you. You're not doing it right. Oh, whatever, I can go. You can find someone to do it, right? But when they get you, those penalties get you. So just something to think about. Don't let it happen to you. Finally, these last couple pages, I know there's a lot of websites here. Export.gov, that's where I'd start. I mean, depending on where you're moving to, there's a lot of good websites, a lot of government funded. You can get lost in the online with some of the websites. But again, just some good information here. The next one's more websites. And with that, I think that's it, right? The next slide to thank you. I'll hold off on questions till the end because it's a live feed. I'll pass it to Peter.
Well, what I'd like to do, if you don't mind, everybody take a 5-minute restroom break, and we'll come back and we'll start. Just 5 minutes exactly. Thank you.